Sorry, I cannot speak any France, but yeah, welcome. Very excited that so many people joined the session. Today we will talk about how to manage an Arca cluster on Kubernetes. In general, Kubernetes is mainly suited for stateless applications, and Arca cluster usually has state. The nodes, they communicate with each other, so it's a little bit more involved, a little bit more complex, and I would like to give you some tips today, what you need to do to manage such cluster efficiently. I'm Markus Jura, or maybe you would say here Markus Jura, doing Scala in Arca now for 7 years. I was working also at Lightband in the Conductor team, which is basically also a deployment tool such as Kubernetes or Marathon on Mesos. Also, Conductor was completely built with Arca clustering and was basically suited and focusing on managing Arca clusters. So I hope I have some knowledge in this space. Nowadays, I'm working at Moya, basically helping the Scala teams to build great products. Sorry for that, for this slide, but so Moya really loves Scala. So half of our backend services are written in Scala. If you don't know what Moya is about, it's a pretty new company that builds a ride-sharing service with a pooling factor. So basically, huge cars, as you see here, we try to congest basically the traffic in the cities by having larger minibuses and then do pooling. So basically taking lots of passengers and driving them efficiently from A to B with fully electric cars. We have offices in Berlin, Finland, as well as Hamburg. So if you're interested, if you want to know more about Moya, please come to me afterwards. But I need to warn you, in general, I mean, Moya, but also this talk is about distributed systems, and this is sometimes quite hard. So if you're kind of new in your career and you think about maybe going into Arca clustering or not, then you should be warned. Leslie Lampert in 87 wrote, "There has been considerable debate over the years about what constitutes a distributed system. It would appear that the following definition has been adopted as at SSC. A distributed system is one in which the failure of a computer didn't even know existed can render your own computer unusable." So it's a tough topic, and if you're digging deeper and deeper into it, it gets more complicated, especially if you do debugging. But therefore, this talk is about mainly three tips. Today we will talk about how to bootstrap a cluster, how to shut down a cluster in a coordinated fashion, and also how to handle network partitions. So first, let's start about bootstrap. So again, compared to a stateless application, when you're dealing with an Arca cluster, the nodes, the instances with each other are communicating. And therefore, it's important when you're starting up a cluster, when you bootstrap a cluster, that this occurs in a certain order. And basically, the Arca team from Lightband, they're working now on the Arca management library for 1 year. And this library really helps to bootstrap a cluster. So I would definitely definitely recommend to use it, and we will basically go through this library through this bootstrap process, how it actually works. So the first phase, if you use this library, is the contact point discovery. So the nodes that have been just started in Kubernetes, the pods, they need to discover themselves so that they can join a cluster. So we are now in a state that basically your Arca application has been started, but a cluster has not joined yet. So they haven't formed a cluster yet. And what they first do is they discover itself with this Arca cluster bootstrap library. And there are different ways to do that. On Kubernetes, the best is to use the Kubernetes API itself. Kubernetes knows which pods are running. So why not just asking Kubernetes? So what the Arca nodes will do is they will basically ask the Kubernetes API, please give me the contact points, the IP addresses of the other nodes by service name. and the service name defaults in Arca to the actor system name. So if you have the same actor system, then obviously also these different instances on the different nodes they should join one Arca cluster. So first phase, they will just ask, okay, give me the IP address of the other nodes with the same actor system, and then they will receive it. Pretty simple. There are also other ways to discover these IP addresses, for instance by DNS, by DNS SRV records, and also by console, for instance. So once they know the IP addresses, they will go into a probing phase. With the Arca management library, if you basically plug that in, it will also start an HTTP server inside of your Arca application, a very small HTTP server, and it will make one endpoint available. And this endpoint, or it will actually make multiple endpoints available, but the most important one is Bootstrap seed nodes. And with that, you basically can ask another node if it already knows certain seed nodes. Maybe one step back, if you want to join an Arca cluster, then you always do that by seed nodes, right? They're basically nodes that are existing, and you only can join an Arca cluster by saying, okay, I want to join this particular seed node. And now Arca management kind of exposes the seed node information via an HTTP endpoint. So now we have here the case that we completely bootstrap a cluster from the scratch, so there's no node running yet, there's no cluster running yet. So in this case, it would just return no seed nodes, right? So therefore we cannot join a cluster because there are no seed nodes. So question is, what happens now? Well, if for a certain period of time, basically, yeah, there are no seed nodes, then one particular node will join itself. But it's important that first a stable time margin has passed. That basically means that no other node with the same actor system has been created as a contact point. You also can configure this margin, and once this margin has passed, one particular node will form a cluster with itself in case no other seed nodes are available. And it's basically pretty simple. The IP address, the lowest IP address wins. So the lowest IP address will form a cluster with itself, and by doing so also will register itself as a seed node. And then basically that will happen always in a certain interval. And then again, in this case, the right node will continue asking the left node, please tell me your seed nodes. Now it would have a seed node information, it will return it, and therefore the right node will also join the left node and form a cluster. All right, so we went now through bootstrapping for a complete new cluster, and also how new members can join an existing cluster. Yep, one question? Okay, then please at the end. And also this joining mechanism is called epidemic joining, meaning that, for instance, when the right node is also part of the cluster, it will also write itself to the seed node registry, so that now a third node could either join over IP2 or over IP1. All right, so let's see that in action. So before I show you the basically how to enable Arca management and Arca cluster bootstrap, let's first go through the Kubernetes config. Oh, I just forgot one slide. So how does the local demo setup looks like? So I've on my local machine, I have deployed a small Kubernetes cluster with Minikube, and we will start 3 Arca instances on this cluster in order that basically the endpoints are accessible from the outside. We will also create a Kubernetes service and also ingress. Ingress is basically a load balancer so that the traffic is balanced, and a service in the Kubernetes world is a resource where you can basically expose your internal ports to the outside. And I will quickly show you now in the demo first how the configuration looks like in case you're new to Kubernetes, and then we will also start the cluster and hopefully see that the bootstrapping worked. So I'm basically here in my Arca SPT project, and to deploy something on Kubernetes, you always need to write configuration files, and these configuration files are written in YAML. Just placed it into the repository, and the structure of a Kubernetes YAML file is that you need to define certain resources. They are called in Kubernetes. The first resource we define is a deployment resource. That's basically how my Arca application is deployed. There are certain configurations you can do. For instance, you can say, okay, how many replicas, how many instances I want to run. Obviously, you need to give it a name, and we will talk about this rolling update later on. Also, what you need to do is you need to, that's like the typical way to define a Docker image. So our Arca application is Dockerized. I'm using here the local Docker registry, and with this name and tag, basically the Kubernetes deployment will load the Docker image. And also important, you need to define certain ports. These ports are not accessible from the outside yet. These are basically only ports that are exposed within the Kubernetes cluster. And we need to define here certain ports so that the individual Arca cluster nodes also can talk with each other. So one is the remoting port. I'm using here Artery. So you can define, I know the port doesn't really matter which number it is, but you need to expose Arca remoting. You also need to expose this Arca management HTTP server so that basically this bootstrap seed node endpoint is available by the Arca nodes. And well, we are having here microservice with an HTTP interface, so I've also exposed my custom HTTP interface. And the other config we will go, we will check out a little bit later, but that's, let's say, mainly the deployment file for now. Then resource file, the service resource in Kubernetes is also pretty straightforward. You give it a name, you define a selector of your deployment. That's basically the name of the deployment above, and you can configure like what kind of port you want to expose to the outside. So in this case, I'm using here the target port 8080. So I want to expose basically my custom, my custom HTTP interface from 8080 to 80. So it will be then exposed to the outside on port 80. Pretty simple. Last resource configuration is ingress. So that's basically the load balancer. By default, it's Nginx on Kubernetes. And here I need to define basically the service name that should be load balanced and on which port as well. So that's the Kubernetes configuration. That's more or less all it takes to deploy it. And then to start the Arca management and the Arca cluster bootstrap module, it's very simple. Basically, in your main, for instance, you can just say Arca management start. Yeah, you can basically get a class of the Arca management by an actor system, then just say start. That starts the HTTP server, and then you also need to start this bootstrap procedure. That's it. So it's basically two lines of code. All right. So now let's see that in action. I've already started Minikube. So if I do, for instance, kube control get pod, in general it works. The Kubernetes cluster is running, but no Arca instances have been started yet. In order to start that, I just need to run basically this configuration file with kubectl apply, and that will basically start the deployment, the ingress, the service, everything. Also, this tool is pretty smart. So if you run it again, it will just see, okay, nothing has changed in the configuration. So even if you only change the deployment, we will actually do that later during a rolling deployment, it will not duplicate the service or the ingress. It only checks what has changed and then applies the changes. Here on the bottom, I've basically using the watch command and using the command kubectl get pod to see the current pods running in my cluster. And as configured, we want to run three replicas. And yeah, now it was successful. So the bootstrap mechanism worked. All right, so let's talk about the second topic. It's about, no, it's not about shutdown. It's actually about, we want to have a coordinated shutdown, right? We don't want to shut down the entire cluster so that we lose in-flight requests or something like that. So we want to have it in a coordinated fashion. And that also gets a little bit involved with Arca clustering, especially if you use tools such as sharding and cluster singleton. So maybe you're thinking it's kind of easy, right? Usually what you need to do is you need to cut the loose ends, like the HTTP layer that we do not retrieve or that we do not accept any incoming connections anymore, any incoming requests. Also, if you have something like asynchronous events, like over Kafka or over SQS, then you also want to ensure that you cut basically the connection there. Usually a Kafka or also Kinesis or SQS is quite smart. As long as you do not basically respond with an acknowledgement, this event will be sent again after a certain period of time and then usually at another instance, right? So quite often, depends what you're using, but on this async event side, you actually don't need to do so much because it kind of in a certain repeated interval, it will always try to send you the message again when you receive it. And as long as you're not acknowledge it, it will then maybe send it to another node, so that's fine. But of course, you need to stop accepting incoming HTTP requests. Then usually what you also need to do is, of course, once everything has been cutted on the top, then in your domain logic, you also want to process the requests that are still in flight, right? You want to wait until the response has been returned to the client. So that's seems kind of simple. With Arca cluster, it gets a little bit more involved because now typically Arca clustering sits around the domain logic, right? If you use Arca cluster sharding, for instance, you quite often shard your let's say domain entities across the Arca cluster, or also can do things with cluster singleton. And what it basically internally does is that maybe the right node directly communicates over Arca remote to the left node, not going over HTTP or not going over Kafka, for instance, right? So you also need to ensure that you basically cut this loose end as well before you basically process the in-flight request and before you terminate the nodes. That's quite often forgotten, and I will show you how to do that. Okay, So it's also kind of very simple. You should use the ARCA coordinated shutdown module. It's a module coming directly in the ARCA library. And in fact, if you change your configuration that you're using not local actors but actors in a clustered fashion, then this coordinated shutdown module is already used, and cluster sharding and cluster singleton is already terminated in a coordinated fashion. But there are still certain things to keep track of. So just for explanation, in general, there are certain phases in this coordinated shutdown module. There's before service unbind. It's a custom phase where you can register things. Usually it's not used because it's in a very early stage of this shutdown. Then there's a phase service unbind. This should be, for instance, used when you're using ARCA HTTP. There you should stop accepting incoming requests. Then there's another phase, service request done, where you should process your in-flight request. So you need to wait until all the in-flight requests has been replied. And just for documentation purposes, there are in total 12 different phases. Here you can see that, for instance, ARCA cluster sharding is basically terminated in phase 6, and cluster singleton in phase 8. And at the end, the actor system will be terminated. And with that, depends again on your configuration, but with that, usually also the JVM. That's also a recommendation on Kubernetes, that the JVM always gets terminated, and then also the pod gets terminated. Yeah, most important one from this slide here is if you're using ARCA HTTP, then you should use basically register something. We will see that in phase 2, and for your in-flight request processing, use phase 3. How can you use it? You also get a handle of the coordinated shutdown module. It's an ARCA extension by passing the actor system, and then you just call at task, and you define at which phase you want to add your custom shutdown logic. You also can give it a name, and so that it's properly locked, and that's it. So pretty simple, right? So that means don't use actor system terminate somewhere in your code. Don't use this.exit. Rather use, when you have like certain shutdown logic, rather you basically add this stop logic. And if you want to trigger a shutdown, then use this API. Also get the coordinated shutdown extension, and then just call run and define a certain reason in case you want to programmatically shut down your application. Because if you directly do actor system terminate, then basically only the last phase will be stopped, and it's not a coordinated shutdown. At the end, also your ARCA cluster and all your actors are stopped, obviously, because they're in a tree hierarchy, but not in the order as ARCA needs it to shut down it in a coordinated fashion. Here's one example for ARCA HTTP. How to register a phase, and also how to trigger the coordinated shutdown programmatically. So we are creating here with bind and handle an HTTP server, and then in this onComplete callback, well, if a failure occurs, that usually is the case when the address is already bound, then you can trigger the coordinated shutdown right away, because, well, you cannot start your HTTP server. And if everything was successful, if the binding was successful, then your HTTP server has been started, and then you can register a task in the coordinated shutdown by saying binding terminate. Binding is the it's the server binding from ARCA HTTP, and that has also a nice terminate method that first does not allow any incoming connections anymore, and then afterwards, after this finite duration here, will unbind the Arc HTTP server. All right. So that was coordinated shutdown in the context of Arca. With Kubernetes, there are a couple of more nitty-gritty things you should consider of. So let's basically go one step more to the top, and let's see that in a Kubernetes context. So, for instance, if you are performing a rolling deployment, then there will be a certain signal that a shutdown of a certain instance should occur. What you now can do, instead of that Kubernetes directly sends a signal to your pod and therefore to your Arca instance and therefore initiates a coordinated shutdown, you can beforehand register a post stop hook that is basically executed before this shutdown signal is sent to the pod. And this is quite handy, because here you can wait for a failing readiness check. So in Kubernetes, we will also see that in a minute, there are readiness checks and liveness checks, and I would encourage you to use them. Once a readiness, or as long as basically this readiness check fails, for instance in the beginning when the bootstrapping is still in progress, then your application is not ready. And as long as it's not ready, Kubernetes will not serve any traffic to this instance, right? And this readiness check can also be used during coordinated shutdown. You can wait for a failing readiness check. Therefore, Kubernetes will not route any traffic to this instance anymore. And then only afterwards you can send the signal, the shutdown signal to the pod, and therefore you are completely safe. So, and that's definitely what I would recommend. So wait for the failing readiness check. Therefore, if it's failed, this instance will not get any HTTP traffic anymore. Afterwards, after the post stop hook, Kubernetes will send the shutdown signal, the sig term, to the Arca instance. And then it's basically the same here. I just repeated it. It's kind of like the fourth step is kind of a safety net. You can do this. Basically, this terminate in your Arca HTTP module, as I showed in the previous slide, it shouldn't be actually necessary because there's no HTTP traffic anymore in general. But yeah, just ensure that as a second safety net that you do not get any connections from any channel anymore. And then again, process in-flight request. Afterwards, cluster shutdown. Then the cluster is left for this particular node, and really at the end the actor system is terminated and the JVM exited. Okay, so let's see that in action. Now we will do a rolling deployment. In this way we will basically demonstrate that how a coordinated shutdown can behave, and we will also check the readiness checks. Okay. So, beforehand I skimmed over these configuration parts, so let's see them now more in detail. So we have this deployment resource again in Kubernetes, and what you can define if you want is a readiness probe and a liveness probe. Liveness basically means that in a certain interval, it's defined here like every 30 seconds, Kubernetes will check if this instance is still alive, and if it's not the case, it will terminate this instance directly, or will basically terminate the pod, and it will restart a new one based on the replica set that you have defined. We have defined 3, so it will always try to match 3. And here, what we did in this case was just defining an HTTP endpoint that we have written in our Arca application, system liveness, that is pretty simple, that basically always returns something if it's alive. But more importantly, let's have a look at the readiness probe. That's another endpoint, system readiness, also in our Arca application. And now and we will see this code in a minute. But first, let's check the pre-stop. I think I said post-stop beforehand, so I'm obviously meant pre-stop hook. So what we are doing here is actually pretty simple. We are executing a bash script, and first we are writing a file just called shutdown on the file system, and then afterwards we wait a certain period of time. And 8 is not here just a random number, but it's also explained here. It's basically the time to wait until the readiness check fails. Only after that, basically, the signal is sent to the pod. And how does it work? How does a readiness check fails? Well, it's a custom implementation. So let's have a check here at this endpoint. Basically, this endpoint, so we are here in readiness, process readiness, checks if this shutdown file has been written. And if it's the case, then it will return service unavailable. And this readiness checks, in my case, will try that 3 times in a certain period, and then basically after 8 seconds, the readiness check failed. And if this shutdown file is not present in the file system, then it will just return 200, okay, and everything is fine, and the application is ready to serve traffic. So that's like a simple trick to do that with Kubernetes. Okay, so let's see that in action. Let's do a deployment. So I've already deployed, or I've already created a Docker image for another version. Currently, we have deployed version 1.0.0. So let's try to deploy 1.0.1. You just change the configuration file, and then what you do is again apply the configuration, and with that, Kubernetes will validate the file, and as you can see, it notified, or it found out that the trip deployment resource has been changed, so it will apply it, and now you can see here that, let's see, that for instance, yeah, it's kind of fast. So this one, maybe we see it with the next one, but here the readiness check failed, therefore ready is now 0 instead of 1, and afterward basically a new instance has been created. And with the Arca cluster, what is also important is that you do not do a very fast rolling deployment. So let's say spin up 3 instances, 3 new, and then shut down the existing ones, the 3 existing ones. You should do that really in a rolling fashion. First stop one, then start one, stop one, start one. Otherwise, you see certain bad behaviors in Arca clustering because it also takes some time, for instance, that the Arca cluster singleton is balanced to another node, or a shard coordinator in cluster sharding also gets balanced to another node. So you should give it a little bit of time. That's kind of a downside with Arca clustering. But yeah, so in general, it worked quite well. All right, that's it for the demo part. So the last topic I would like to talk about is split brain resolution. So with the Arca cluster, it's also important that you do not end up in a split brain scenario. So that, and there are certain reasons how a split brain actually could occur. One would be that you end up in a network partition. So let's imagine we have here 3 Arca cluster nodes in 3 different data centers. On AWS, you would say 3 different availability zones. And I mean, these 3 Arca cluster nodes, they're communicating with each other via Arca remoting, right? And what happens now if a network partition occurs? Then, well, at the end, basically the node in data center 2 cannot communicate with the one in data center 1 and 3, and vice versa. So what should happen in this case? How should an Arca cluster behave in this case? So what it definitely shouldn't do is that the right-hand side just continue working and, let's say, still continue serving traffic, like HTTP traffic, maybe from users that are on the right-hand side in this data center, and the same on the left-hand side, because then these nodes, they will diverge. And what will actually happen, again, depends on your configuration, but, well, this node will not see these nodes, right? So it could form a cluster with itself. Then, for instance, it will create Arca cluster sharding, or the Arca cluster sharding on this ends. If a new request is coming in for, let's say, an order that is actually on this side, it will also basically create the order here, because it's not aware of that the order is actually on the left-hand side. So you definitely should avoid like the split brain scenario, or in other words, in a network partition, you definitely should avoid that both sides still are living and serve traffic. Instead, what you should do is you need to shut down one part of the network partition. So how does it work in Arca cluster? In general, Arca comes with a failure detection mechanism. Arca itself internally uses gossiping to always check, hey, is basically DC, or is Arca node in DC1 or in DC3 still available or not, right? So it will send basically gossip or messages in a gossip fashion to one or the other node. And in this case, node in DC3 sends a message to DC1, and therefore it still knows that DC1 is available, so everything is fine. Then maybe the node in DC1 will send a message to DC2, but it fails because it will not get a response. Therefore, basically it will get marked as something is wrong on DC1. And then maybe basically node on DC1 will send another gossip message to DC3 informing that something is wrong with DC2. Then maybe DC3 will try again, and so forth. And after a certain period of time, the failure detector has a consensus, and then Arca cluster will mark, in this case, for the left-hand side, basically the node in DC2 will be marked as unreachable, and vice versa, right? For the node in DC2, both nodes on the left-hand side will be marked as unreachable. The failure detector in Arca is based on the Phi actual failure detector. I think also Manuel Bernhard, I think just 2 hours ago, talked a little bit more in depth about this topic. I've also linked the paper in case you're more interested. So once a node is marked as unreachable, that means that no new members can join the cluster. So it's kind of like in an unhealthy situation. And basically Arca cluster then saying, well, keep down. I'm not allowing now to that new members can join, and we need to do something about it. But Arca itself, if you're just using Arca cluster out of the box, doesn't handle this unreachable node. It doesn't down the node. And for that, you need the Arca split brain resolver. That's like an additional library you need to plug in when you use Arca clustering, and that will actually down, for instance, the node in DC2. And there are different strategies how you can down a node. For instance, there's a static chrome, keep majority, So one of these are usually used where they down the nodes on the minority side. So in our case, it was the right-hand side. Keep majority is a little bit more flexible. So this strategy you also can use if you do auto-scaling, scaling up, scaling down in a, maybe based on peak times. If you have like a cluster that is always 3-node or always 5-node or always 7-node, then I would recommend to use static quorum. That's a little bit more simple. Also, the libraries, they have this strategy correctly implemented. There are also strategies like keep oldest, keep referee. So oldest is basically the oldest node, keep referee. You there can assign a node that will then be kept, and also the basically all other nodes that are on the side will be kept. There are different libraries out there that you can use. In general, I would recommend to use the library directly from Lightband, but it comes with a catch. You need to basically have a Lightband subscription, so it's commercial. If you don't have a Lightband subscription or you don't want to get one, then there are also a couple of open source libraries out there. Some of them are not perfectly implemented, especially some of them do not have all the strategies implemented, have maybe minor errors, and of course the Lightband Splitbrain resolver always gets maintained. If a new Arca version comes out, if a new Arca feature comes out, it always gets maintained. The open source libraries are not very well maintained. If I would recommend one, then it would be Arca Cluster Custom Downing. Also at Moya we did evaluation of all these libraries. If you have a subscription, definitely take the one from Lightband. That's it already. Thank you very much. The code is on GitHub. So if you also want to check basically how a stateful application is actually implemented, how the configuration of Kubernetes looks in detail, how to shut down basically Arca cluster sharding code properly, then check out this repository or follow me on Twitter on GitHub. Thank you very much. So any questions? Did I answer your question?
Not really, but I'm not sure. Maybe I didn't understand something at the beginning. Sorry. So I had a question about a bootstrap of a cluster. Mm-hmm. Because you said after a moment, if a node didn't detect a seed node, I don't remember, the configuration key.
This one?
Yeah, seed node. So if a node didn't get something, he start himself like a cluster. So if several nodes start at the same time, do you have a strategy to merge several cluster or something like this?
Yes. So that's an important question. So if we start like lots of nodes at the same time, how do I know which node should actually form a cluster with itself so that the others can join? That's based on the lowest IP address. So basically they know all the contact points, all the IP addresses of the nodes with the same actor system name. And basically this Arca cluster bootstrap library has a logic that then the node with the lowest IP address will form a cluster with itself and the others not. So that's a trick.
My question is about the network partition. At which level the resolver is deployed?
Basically this resolver is deployed on every node, and based on the failure detection, it then basically knows which node to down.
But there isn't a risk of split brain also into failure detection. We can perhaps have two failure detectors.
Two failure detectors?
What do you mean by that? I don't know. Yes, in this case, if a failure detection is started also in the other side.
Sorry, I didn't get your question. But so, I mean, in general, so the split brain resolver is deployed on every node, and it basically then knows based on the ARCA cluster state which nodes it sees. So always from a local node point of view, and in this case, so let's say we are using the strategy static quorum, right? Then we know, okay, we have a three-node cluster, and that's a fixed size. So now, if basically for the left-hand side, DC2 is unreachable, then basically still this node and this node knows, okay, I see two of them, and only one is unreachable. So I stay, and I will not shut down myself. And this node, on the other hand, only sees itself, so doesn't see the other ones. It knows from the configuration that the static quorum is 3, and therefore it will shut down itself.
Okay, thank you.
Hello. My question is more about, let's say you've got some unresponsive server in your cluster, and my experience with Akka cluster was, it was not with Kubernetes, but with Mesos, a bit similar. So when the system attempts to restart the same node, let's say using the same port and same IP, then Akka is saying, hey, I've seen that that node as unreachable before, and now there's this node that's trying to join my cluster, and since it's unreachable, so I'm just not letting him come. So how do you fix that that type of issue? Have you encountered that before?
Because you don't have a split
brain. Okay. The resolver resolves the situation. All right. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Manuel.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.